It's the ways in which we unwittingly perpetuate racism through our structures, through our, even through our spirituality.
Those very same counties that overproduce debt, right, are the same counties that clear the fewest felonies, lowest percentage of felonies.
And they really don't have much context or history about the salience of race as an issue in the United States.
I'm Brian Wade. Watch me every week on this station.
Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. Worlds Apart is a program that looks to investigate how racism, ethnocentrism, cultural, and social divide manifest themselves within our society. Worlds Apart will consider the historic, scientific, cultural, and social factors that perpetuate these issues. Additionally, Worlds Apart was created to serve as a constructive dialogue piece around a topic that has been very polarizing and very controversial. Worlds Apart is an attempt is not trying to be malicious, but constructive, and to provide an ongoing discussion and best practices with respect as how can we move our society forward on an issue that in a lot of ways we really don't want to address. It evolves over time in terms of some of the perspectives and some of the approaches in terms of how to best deal with that. And our programs in the year 2008, Happy New Year, will look to address the sort of evolving models around race in the various institutional disciplines such as medicine, science, politics, education, the corporate workplace. Again, we're glad to have been on air 10 years now, going in on our 11th year in 2008. And we'd like to thank all of our corporate support that makes this program possible. The issue of psychiatry and psychology, it's not much spoken about with respect to the issue of race or cultural competency, but I think, you know, as I've looked at this issue of cultural competency, there tends to be and seems to be now more of a discussion in terms of, well, how culturally competent are we when it comes to providing assessments around psychology and psychiatry? And I have with me from the Greensboro, North Carolina region of the United States, Dr. Edward Morris, and he's a clinical psychologist. And today's program, we're going to discuss cultural competency with respect to psychology. At this time, I'd like to introduce my guest in the person of Dr. Morris. Welcome to Worlds Apart, Dr. Morris.
Thank you. It's my pleasure, and I look forward to being part of the discussion.
Okay, very good. Dr. Morris, give us some background about yourself for someone who may not know you.
Well, as you said, I'm a clinical psychologist and didn't start out as a clinical psychologist. Started out as a social worker and realized after I became a social worker that they don't eat a lot because they don't pay a lot. But I also realized that there were skills that I wish that I had at the time, especially when it came to understanding people of color as a diagnostician that I didn't have as a result of my training as a social worker. And so it was for that reason. Primarily, I decided to go back and get my PhD in clinical psychology. And the program that I went to was unique because it offered part of the curriculum was in community psychology. The other part was in clinical psychology. So it had that community-based approach in looking at a number of issues, particularly as they pertain to underrepresented populations.
Okay. Dr. Morris, so you sort of made a point about you wish you would have had more training as a social worker in terms of the issue of culture or being more culturally competent. So I guess that's something that's really institutional in terms of, I guess, the lack of cultural competency, would you say?
Oh, I think it's institutional, systemic, and I think it's reflective of the need to restrict the information that is out there in terms of understanding people from a cross-cultural perspective. Mm-hmm. A lot of professional schools, they have as part of their curriculum based on accreditation requirements that there is some exposure to cross-culturalism, either as part of the therapy piece or part of the testing piece. But usually, it's not something that's infused throughout the education. They may get one course, they may get one day, they may get one speaker, and it's more of an exception than the rule to have that particular topic to be part of, to be an integral part of anything that they do, either as diagnosticians or as therapists.
Well, Dr. Morris, well, we're going to, you know, have a good opportunity to talk more about, you know, this issue. But, you know, I guess one of the questions I would have, why is it important that the clinician diagnosticians be culturally competent or have a cross-cultural perspective regarding psychology and psychiatry?
Well, first, let me just sort of back up a little.
Sure.
People have been talking about cultural competency for a number of years, and it seems that that's become like the catchphrase.
Politically correct.
To capture a whole phenomenon that's almost like the new cereal of the week. One of the things that struck me is that it's hard to for anyone to truly be competent in any particular area.
Okay.
And so I kind of like thinking of it as being proficient. The more you do, the more proficient you become. And the more you study a particular phenomenon, the more effective as well as efficient that you can become. So if you don't mind, I like to use the word cultural proficiency instead of cultural competency.
The program's so yours. Okay.
Construct, you kind of wrap your finger on, you can kind of do something with it, and it gives you something more tangible to use as an instructor or as well as a clinician.
Dr. Morris, let's look historically at just the institution of psychology and I guess some of their mindset as far as how they went forth in terms of trying to make assessments. Give us a history if you want to go back to the turn of the century, please.
Okay. Now, I'm having a hard time hearing you.
Okay.
Is there a way you could turn your mic up a little?
Okay, well, I want to give us a history regarding the institution of psychology and psychiatry with respect to assessments and diagnostics. Yes, go ahead.
There are, oh, good Lord, at least 20,000 psychologists in this country. And when I graduated from school, there were maybe 200 to 300 psychologists of color, particularly African-American psychologists. And we're talking the late 70s and early 80s. And around that time, there was a swell among the African-American psychologists that a lot of the material that was written about us really didn't have a truly cross-cultural perspective and certainly didn't have an Afrocentric perspective. And so a number of the earlier African-American psychologists decided that they wanted to change that because they figured that we need to have a new knowledge base that was more accurate of our experiences versus the experiences that were being portrayed by people who were European-American, represented a Eurocentric perspective. And so some of the earlier African-American psychologists like Naeem Akbar and Jenna Helms and Thomas Parham and some of those, and Robert Williams, they really were some of the pioneers that really looked at the whole phenomena of understanding African-American culture from an Afrocentric perspective.
Dr. Morris, what we need to do now is pause some words from our sponsors. We'll come back and continue our conversation. If you're just not tuning in, I have Dr. Edward Morris from Greensboro, North Carolina, who's a clinical psychologist, and we're looking at the issue of psychology from a cross-cultural perspective. And what we'd like to do now is pause some words from our sponsors. Stay tuned. We'll be back to Worlds Apart.
Looking to buy or sell your home? Contact Monica Archie. Several years of real estate experience. Make the right choice for your realtor for life. Monica Archie.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by The Bonton.
Hi, my name is Dr. Stephen Jones, and I've written a wonderful book titled 7 Secrets of How to Study. How many of you have a student that's struggling in school, trying to take tests, thinking about their motivation level, knowing that they're not ready or able to get the types of grades that they would like? Well, I've written this book, 7 Secrets of How to Study, to show them what they need to do to manage their time, to get organized, and to make sure that they're eliminating all stresses as they're preparing for each individual test. I've also written a book for parents to help parents know how to organize and help their students to do better in school. And I'm writing a scholarship book that should be forthcoming. I want you to have a student that knows exactly what they need to do when they go to every class, how they should manage their time, how they should prepare for difficult examinations, and let them know that there's a resource that they can do to train themselves to do better in every class. You have potential to be successful if you'll use this book, and you will have an A on every class.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by Wolf Printing.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Worlds Apart. If just not tuning in, I have on the phone from Greensboro, North Carolina, Dr. Edward Morris, who's a clinical psychologist. And we're talking about cultural competency, or as Dr. Morris has said, cultural proficiency with respect to, I guess, various institutional professionals in various institutions. And a question that was asked, and we have guests in our audience, although you can't see them on television. Dr. Morris, they want to ask you, what could be missed in terms of diagnosis or assessment with respect to a person or a clinician not being culturally proficient?
You can miss, it's possible that you can miss the entire person. Because if you have, for example, a lot of African-American males, especially young males, they tend to be much more verbal, much more assertive than a lot of their European-American counterparts. And if you have an individual who's sort of filling his oats and feeling confident and comfortable and with a healthy self-esteem and a healthy sense of narcissism, and if he goes to a psychologist who's not familiar with that particular pattern, that particular style, I can easily see how he would misinterpret that as being something more pathological, something much more aggressive, something that would fall into the kind of disorder category or disruptive behavior when it's just his way of expressing himself. Or you may have an older gentleman who's African-American, depending on his age, he's going to present a different persona that could easily be misinterpreted as something that's far from what really is going on. The thing that we often miss is that in order to be able to get beyond the shell that we often have, the cultural shell, is that you have to have a relationship with the individual. And it's not necessarily the race of the evaluator, although it can certainly make a difference. The typical Eurocentric mindset doesn't allow time, energy, or resources, or even the notion that a relation really does begin with you respecting the person, understanding the culture, and somehow giving some cues that you've done your work to go beyond what they're used to experiencing whenever they go into a predominantly Eurocentric institution. Not many people do that, because we have this mindset within the field of psychology, within the field of social work, and even especially within the field of psychiatry, that we have all the answers and that we have to give those answers to the other, to our clients, and their job is to fill in the blanks. And that's such a backwards way of doing things, because if we follow the model that the client's supposed to guide the treatment plans, the diagnosis, and all those other things, then really does require a blending of the two cultures and a sense of respect for what the person brings to us, regardless of where they're at in terms of their socioeconomic status or their experiences. The Eurocentric model assumes that people operate in a linear fashion and that there's a cause and effect for everything. Well, with a lot of the clients that are of color or underrepresented, it's not always that simple, because there's a multitude of factors that impact our daily lives. And even me, as a clinical psychologist, always find that I have to interpret a lot of my experiences through multiple lenses before I can come to a place where I can truly understand where the person's coming from. If you have a person who's dealing with the normal stresses of life and have to deal with some of the institutionalized racism that's out there, well, they don't have the time, they don't have the energy, and so you're naturally going to have a different mindset whenever they go and talk to a psychiatrist or a psychologist. And it's real easy for that particular message to get misconstrued or misinterpreted, and as a result, it's easy to misdiagnose the person.
Dr. Morris, let me ask this question. The whole notion of what it means to be black, and I know you're talking about becoming more proficient from a cross-culture perspective. Okay, say one becomes more proficient in terms of saying, well, looking at, I guess, psychology or psychiatry from an ethnic perspective, you have so many different kinds of experiences within any particular ethnic group. How do you come up with a model that's fluid but yet accurate in terms of assessing or diagnosing people based on ethnicity?
The model, there are a number of things that you can use. There are a number of good diagnostic tools out there. For example, if you're looking at a person's cognitive functioning, there are some tests that are much more culturally biased than others. And those that are, didn't say that none of them are culturally biased, because all of them are culturally biased, because they were done within a Eurocentric perspective. But there are a couple that are less culturally biased than others. So I would certainly look at the person's experience and proficiency and work with those particular measures. The other thing that I would look at is how knowledgeable is the person about the African American family or the Hispanic American family or whatever group that they work with, and how much of that knowledge is a truly working knowledge that's based on their experience with that particular population, as well as the intellectual understanding of the population. A lot of clinicians, they may have a couple of friends who are of color, or they may have been to a couple of workshops where they talk about a particular culture group, but when you look at the actual empirical information that they might have, a lot of them are lacking. And that's where the disconnect occurs, because it's the blending of the cognitive stuff along with the experiential stuff that really allows a person to start moving in the direction of being culturally proficient. If you have one without the other, it's just like wearing half of a jacket without realizing that you don't have the other half of a jacket until someone points it out. But unfortunately, we don't take time to have enough dialogue to realize what's missing, so we just sort of keep perpetuating the same old, year after year.
Dr. Morris, we have like a minute left, and we can get into this question after we come back from break. But in terms of academia, in terms of training clinicians, what kinds of curriculum modifications or retrofitting is taking place to include this becoming more culturally proficient in terms of better training clinicians and diagnosticians? And, you know, we have like maybe 30 seconds, so we'll probably need to answer that when we come back from break. So we can do that. How about that, Dr. Morris?
That sounds like a good idea.
Okay. Yeah, I know you got a lot to say there. So what we'd like to do now is pause some words from my sponsors. If you're just now tuning in, I have with me on the phone from Greensboro, North Carolina, Dr. Edward Morris. He's a clinical psychologist, and I had the opportunity to meet him as a result of my working in mental health currently. So what we'd like to do is pause, and we'll continue our conversation regarding cross-cultural training and sensitivity with respect to the issue of psychology and psychiatry. So stay tuned. We'll be back to Worlds Apart.
Whether it's in the city, the country, or somewhere in between, owning your own home means something special, something comfortable and secure. No wonder it's a dream we all share. We're the Pennsylvania Housing Finance Agency, working to put safe, affordable housing within reach of every citizen. Find out more by visiting phfa.org, because it doesn't have to be just a dream.
Hershey Foods Corporation supports the efforts of Worlds Apart in promoting the understanding, acceptance, and value of diversity.
At WellSpan Health, we understand what women need and what women want. That's why we've created something unique for our region. Healthcare programs, diagnostics, and treatments exclusively for women. We call it Well Women at WellSpan. Special care and insightful information for everything from high-risk pregnancies to midlife health and more. Well Women at WellSpan. Don't you love it when someone really understands your needs?
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bonton Stores Foundation.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just not tuning in, I have with me on the phone from Greensboro, North Carolina, Dr. Edward Morris, who's a clinical psychologist. And we're looking at the issue of, as I stated, cultural competency with respect to psychology and psychiatry. But Dr. Morris feels that there's probably a better apt term, or more accurate term, is of maybe being more proficient in terms of, you know, diagnosing and assessments. And he's my guest for the program. Dr. Morris, before we went to break, I was asking you, is academia, in terms of preparatory training, doing a better job in terms of providing the tools with respect to modifying curriculum in terms of training?
They're doing a better job. They're not doing as good of a job as they could. And the reason that they're doing a better job is because you have more and more people of color, especially African Americans, who are in academia, and so they're holding a system more accountable. The unfortunate part is that in order to survive within academia, you need to be able to show that you have articles within referee journals. Well, that's a problem, because those individuals who truly are on the cutting edge of understanding culture proficiency, they tend to be much more radical in their thinking and may not be able to present the material in a way that would be acceptable and accepted by the referee journal. And so it ends up being a second-tier or third-tier journal before for a number of years before it comes to the forefront. And so there's a almost like a time delay before the information catches up with the experiences of people. And then it's like the first time they've heard it, but it's been around for a while. And the other thing is that I don't think that a lot of the institutions that hold the students accountable in terms of making sure that they truly understand people from cross-cultural perspectives. They may accept one note or two notes from about a particular client, but as far as really looking at the literature, incorporating that into their write-ups, and making sure that if they have a person who is of color, what specific issues within their culture phenomenon did you explore with the individual? What most institutions do is that they have a template that they use for all people, and if the person is slightly different, then they'll accept a statement or two. But given that the literature is at the other end of the continuum in terms of what we know about African Americans, there's not that level of accountability that needs to be put into place. So it's going to continue to be a problem.
Okay. Dr. Morris, one of the questions that was asked here in the studio was looking at, I guess, the varying perspectives within the minority community or the black community in terms of the need for assessments. Do the perceptions vary as far as one's willingness to come forward and one's unwillingness to come forward?
Okay. Well, it really depends on a couple of factors.
Okay.
One has to do with socioeconomic status, and the other has to do with gender. We know that for a lot of males, we ain't going to go unless there's some absolutely dire need for us to go because a woman's about to walk out on us or our mate's saying that they're going to throw us in front of a train or our kid's about to go to jail. It's just one of those things that's hardwired into us. Fortunately, as more and more of us become middle class, we understand and can appreciate the need of having an objective person listen to our problems. But as a unfortunate problem, it's more difficult to get African-American males in the therapy than it is to get African-American females.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing has to do with socioeconomic status. For individuals who aren't middle class and not used to having that therapy as being just a normalized part of the experience, they're not going to use that. And part of it has to do with history, because for years and years and years, whenever people of color, especially African-Americans, would go to mental health centers or psychiatrists or other folks, then they would be treated as if they are second-class citizens without a voice or without a history or without the good sense to be able to figure out their problems. So they were talked to instead of experienced with the individual, or they would present some treatment strategies that were just so culturally incongruent that the individual sit there and nah, say, yeah, I'll try that and I'll do that. They'll walk in and say, that person's crazier than I am.
Mm.
Or the individual that's doing the assessment might come with an interpretation that is so off that it would just turn the person off. And I think for a number of decades, we've got so used to dismissing people because we just assumed that they couldn't relate to us because of the racial differences or cultural differences. And when you run to an experience that reinforce that notion, then it's just easier to dismiss the entire system.
Right.
And that's the unfortunate part,
right?
Because there are a number of us who are depressed who could benefit from medication. There are a number of us who are so stressed out that we don't even know whether we're coming or going. We could certainly use medication. Or there are a number of families that are on the brink of disaster, and we could use some intervention, but because of all these reasons, we don't take advantage of the resources that are there. And so we end up becoming our worst nightmare out of our own ignorance, out of our own pride, out of our own stubbornness. And that's the downside of it.
Dr. Morris, we have less than 2 minutes. Just give us some practical things that we can do in terms of, I guess, counterbalancing stress. You know, and I know stress tends to rise more, and maybe I shouldn't stereotype like that based on socioeconomic conditions. What are some tips that people can do? We got about a minute and a half.
Well, at the top of the list, communication.
Okay.
It's something that you can't overemphasize, but I think that we've gotten so used to talking to all the wrong people that we forget that the person that we need to talk to is the one that we probably have the most intimate relationship with. if you are feeling stressed because of a relationship, then you need to go to the person and you need to, as humbly as possible, present what it is that you want. And sort of look at the three fingers that are pointing back at you and start with, I apologize, forgive me, and kind of move from there. I think that we also need to not throw the baby out with the bathwater, and just because we don't like what we hear from other people, just dismiss them altogether. I think we need to be more open-minded and to any number of other possibilities. Mm-hmm. Around this time, people are going to talk a lot about health and wellness and stuff like that. And I'm amazed at how much we talk about it, but how little we actually do those things as a way to release a lot of the stress that's inside of us.
Well, Dr. Morris, I don't have much time, and I don't want to create any more stress for myself as far as getting off the air on time. But I want to thank you so much for being my guest today, and I look forward to working with you in the future. You've consented to work as my consultant in the area of mental health for the program, so we look forward to working with you. And thank you so much again for Worlds Apart. I'm Brian Wade. Good evening, good night, and God bless.
The African American History Minute. Today's trivia question is, what year was the Amistad Rebellion? Today's featured African American is Asa Philip Randolph. Randolph started the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters, a union for African American Pullman Railroad car attendants. The formation of the Brotherhood was considered the first serious effort to organize the Pullman Company. The Pullman Company was one of the most powerful business organizations in the country. The Brotherhood came to be viewed as a symbol of the African Americans' claim to dignity, respect, and a decent livelihood. Now, back to our trivia question. What year was the Amistad Rebellion? The answer is 1839. For more information about Asa Philip Randolph, visit our website at historyminute.org. Until next time, remember, we're standing on the shoulders of giants.